Say that again.
That we're going to use the mew.
The meal.
The mew.
Oh, the mew. We're going to use mew. Why?
Because
tell me why.
There's not a percentage for the metal.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Read that again. This copy came out awful. There is though. Right, right, right. The proportion. Look for keywords. There is no percentage sign. Thank you, Luna, for bringing that up. There is no percentage sign, but this is unfortunately the way we indicate percentages, proportions, fractions, decimals in our lives. That 0.135 that is down there, and please take a look at the words right after it, is it different than 0.135, comma, the proportion of those who experience? So we are testing proportions again. We're testing proportions based on a decimal representation of that. I know above it said 12%. I could have just easily put 0.112 and referred to it as a percentage. But this is definitely a proportion. It's a 0.135. Fair? Fair. Is that okay? So, well, just, two things to think about right now. First of all, for the remainder of the day and maybe even into Thursday, we're testing proportions. Secondly, if you look just to the left at the beginning of each data set, I tell you what we're testing. That might be helpful too. That's to be nice. Look that on there. So just so you know, it's there waiting for you. Because we're learning. So that's why it's so important. And yeah, also, what's another clue that probably tells you we're testing proportions?
It says proportions.
Well, it says that. Give me another clue.
Oh, we have, because there's numbers,
yeah.
Say the two words between. I heard Melanie say 121 and 710, and there were two very small, very important words between them. 121
out of
710. That's a percentage, isn't it? I mean, it's in fractional form, but it's still a percentage, yes? It's 121 out of 710. So there's all kinds of little clues that you're dealing with proportions. Look for the X in the N. Look for the X in the N that gives you a percentage, that gives you a fraction. So thank you, Linda, for pointing that out, because that's good too. Identifying what you're testing is huge, especially in this early phase. Okay, good. So forget the sample data for a moment. You are creating a drug, Prevnar. And if you've got a leading competitor, I'm not sure if I quoted a leading competitor out there, it's not important if I did or not. And every drug has potential what?
Side effects.
Side effects. And one of the side effects is going to be loss of appetite. And you want to see how Prevnar stacks up with other medications. Okay? Now you have no idea how Prevnar is going to stack up against its competing medications. It might make loss of appetite worse. It might make loss of appetite better. Maybe kids get less of a loss of appetite using Prevnar than their competing medicine. So you have no idea going in. Like with a flu vaccine, you kind of know what you're trying to do. You're trying to make people get the flu
less.
So you know you're going to go in there with a less than sign because you want to make people get sick less. But when you're making drugs and checking side effects, you just want to see if it's changing from the norm. So we know from the norm, these kids get sick at what rate? Or excuse me, they don't get sick. They get loss of appetite at what rate? 13.5%, right? 0.135? Would it be more helpful if I put 13.5% like that rather than 0.135? Yes, okay, good. So on the Z curve, we call that zero. All right? So here we go. Suppose, let's just play the suppose game. Suppose we do a study and the results come back and they land right here. What do you say about Prevnar's rate of appetite loss versus competing medicine? Any different? I heard it, not really. Good. I love the sound and I love the phrase, not really. Good. How about over here? About the same thing, but on the other side, not really a difference, yes? How about down here? Yeah, I'd say something's different. As a matter of fact, kids are probably getting appetite loss less if we land down here, yes? How about up here? Now kids are getting appetite loss more than the competing medicine. So the question is, where do we land? Now, do you see how I bold italicized the word different and not greater than or less than? I bold italicized the word different because when you're starting this study and you've never tested the drug before, you have no idea where it's going to land, but you have to pick. You have to pick something to test. So very often, statisticians, and wisely so, will just pick a different rather than a less than or greater than. And I love this. Let's begin. Let's fill the template out. We're getting ahead of ourselves a little bit. First of all, we've decided what variable we're testing. We are testing little p. What is little p going to be in words?
A portion of those infants that did not have loss of appetite.
That did, but what are they taking? The drug Prevnar. Put what Alan and Kendra and Amaya said together. We're testing appetite loss on infants that use Prevnar. Now some of you are saying, what the hell? Why are we using Prevnar? We're looking at this null curve. Because we're comparing Prevnar to that curve, yes? We want to see if Prevnar lives on that curve, or Linda lives where? If it's not on that curve, where is it? Maybe off the curve, right? That's the idea. Is it likely on this curve? This is the competing medicines curve, yes? Is Prevnar the same as this with appetite loss, or is it way lower or way higher? I don't know. But what we're going to check is, we're going to see, what is the, what word do you guys like best? Rate? Rate of appetite loss? Is that okay? Percentage? Proportion? Percentage! Percentage of appetite loss in, not with, in kiddos using Prevnar. That's what we're testing. We're trying to see the rate of appetite loss in kids using our drug. And we're going to compare it to the appetite loss in the kids using the other drug, and we're going to see if they're roughly the same or if they're different in some way. Let's stop right there. Let that wash over you. Ask me questions. Gesundheit. Goodness, lots of sneezes. Stay hydrated, folks. Stay thirsty. Does this make, do you see why we're putting the 13.5% on there? Let's make sure we start with that. You see why 13.5% is there? So, McKenna, go.
So that's the competing drugs.
Yes, sir.
That's motivation.
Yes, sir. And we're trying to see if Prevnar is different than it, or arguably the same. That's what we're trying to see. Where does Prevnar live on that competing curve? If it lives near the middle, then Prevnar's got the same rate of appetite loss, right? If it lives on one of the ends, then it's probably different. So the question is, we don't know where it lives. That's why we draw a sample and look at it. Good. More questions. That was a great one. Go, Linda.
So would we be on this one, maybe I'm getting too far ahead, where we'd actually gray out both sides? So
that's exactly correct. Exactly. That's what makes it a slightly different test. Yes, Di, the one you graphed last time, that's what this was going to be this time.
Okay.
Fantastic. Yes. Good. More questions. Yes, absolutely. You are a little bit ahead of ourselves, but we'll get to that.
So 13.5% is the null?
Yes. So, thank you. Let's do step three now, Jolene. Step three is write the hypotheses out, yes? Write the hypotheses out. Two hypotheses, yes? Let's back. Let's see what the hell's going on. Two hypotheses. Okay, now. Good. I like to start with the research hypothesis, I think. So what is it going to be in symbols? Let me see hands on this one. Let me see hands on this one. What is this going to be in symbols? In symbols. Be brave. What variable first?
P.
Little p, yes?
Little p.
Which is the percentage of appetite loss in kiddos using Prevnar. And we're going to try to see if it's different.
So it's different. So how do you know if it's not as one?
Different. Ah, good. Different. Yes, that's good. So what Melanie and Alan are both getting at is, wait a minute, damn it. If it's different, how do you know if it's less than or greater than? Check them both. We'll find out. Check them both by testing does not equals. That's a terrible does not equals sign. I got excited. I apologize. Does not equals. That way you don't have to pick. You can let the statistics show you where it is. Yes. Fair, good, maybe. Alan, fair, good. Thank you for that. McKenna, go.
So what makes this one different than the last one?
The word different. Because, that sounds like a smart-ass thing to say, and I apologize. Yeah. But in the previous one, we were trying to show that our flu vaccine lowered flu rates. The key word was lowered. Here, we're just trying to see if we're different. Did you see the context there? The context is what you're trying to see the data imply. And, you know, honestly, many statisticians only run what these guys are called two-tailed tests, where, as Linda's already correctly pointed out, there's going to be shading on both sides, absolutely, and they only run that because they don't like having any presupposed notions going into a test. They say, let's just see if something changed. It becomes a pure what? What were you asking about at break? it becomes a pure. You said you like doing one thing better in this class than hypothesis testing?
Confidence.
It becomes a pure confidence interval because it has two sides, less than, greater than. Yes. So it turns into that. Many statisticians go right to this every time. But we're not quite done yet. What number goes there? Absolutely. You guys are nailing that. That makes me happy. 0.135. Is it okay if I put that there? Sorry, I wrote it already. You live with it?
Would it be okay if we did?
Oh, of course! 13.5%, of course. Absolutely. You just can't put that in your TI. I'll get pissed. You have to put it as a decimal. Why? I don't know. I don't understand why they want it. What goes? What's the null? This is actually a pure equals, yes. Because what's the opposite of does not equal? Equal. Good stuff. Ask me questions. Go, Kendra, yes.
So after we run this, what number are we looking for to see?
Still 5%. Still 5%.
Okay.
We're still checking for 5%. That doesn't change. We're still looking for a small p-value, which would, this case, mean that the rate of appetite loss is
different.
And what's cool about that is, if you get a small, I'll get ahead of myself. Let's come back in that 10 minutes. I don't want to get too far ahead. But yeah, this is our belief. We think, or it's not much a belief. We want to see if the rate of appetite loss is different. Otherwise, it hasn't changed. So this is going to be your confidence interval. We're going to see if we're outside of it, if you will. Jolene.
So if we run our test,
yes,
the null is correct, we will get exactly 0.135?
Hold that thought. No, not necessarily. Actually, we get, not necessarily. That's sampling error. Sampling error can imply that it's no different than 13.5, but as long as it's close, 13.9, 12.8, whatever, might be close enough within the sampling error. So the idea is the test shows you where the sampling error is, basically, in graphical form. Now we could run this as a confidence interval, and you know what? What the hell, let's do it right now. Let's take a pause on the template, and since you guys have been bringing it up, and I love the fact you're bringing it up, run a confidence interval on this data. And then we'll see, Veronica, we can answer your question, how it ties back perfectly to hypothesis testing.